In this movie, I'm going to discuss the equivalent circuit of an axon and the electronic components that comprise axons. So this is a drawing of the electronic components that comprise the axon. The outside is indicated in blue. That's the extracellular fluid. And the inside of the axon is indicated by white. And as you can see, there are 1, 2, 3, 4 different blocks there. Each of these blocks represents the building block of an axon and the electronic components that comprise those building blocks. And there are 3 that are of significance. The first one is shown here. It's labeled CM, and it stands for membrane capacitance. And what that means is the membrane is actually the equivalent of an electronic component called a capacitor. And a capacitor is something that students, or at least most students, have very little familiarity with, and this causes them to freak out to no end. It isn't that difficult. I'll explain it to you simply in just a few moments. The second component is the membrane resistance. And what that refers to is how difficult it is for current to flow through the ion channels in a membrane. And that just means how many ion channels are open. That's really what it refers to. And again, I will explain this to you in greater detail in just a few moments. And the third thing is the R internal, which stands for the internal resistance of the axon. So now what I'd like to do is explain this to you by using an illustration of an axon shown in the lower part of the figure. And here I've put in a bunch of channels. They happen to be purple potassium channels, but the kind of channel doesn't really matter at all. And here's the point. First, let's consider the capacitance. And the capacitor is nothing more than the cell membrane. What a capacitor is simply an insulator that separates 2 conductive plates. The insulator in this case, of course, is the cell membrane, and one conductive plate is the extracellular fluid, which is salty, and the other plate is the intracellular fluid, which is also salty. And they hold and separate charges across the insulation. And in this case, it's the resting potential. Negative charges on the inside relative to positive charges on the outside. That's all it means. The next component is the membrane resistance. And as I've indicated to you, that's determined simply by the number of ion channels that are open, because they determine the resistance to current flow through the membrane. So if there are no channels that are open, the current flow is almost infinite. The membrane resistance is extremely high. If we open a channel, now current can flow through that channel and the resistance is reduced. And if we open another channel, even more current can flow and the resistance is further reduced. Hence, the membrane resistance simply is an indication of how many open ion channels there are in the membrane at any one time. And the third thing is the internal resistance of the axon. And what that's going to be determined by is the size of the axon, because that's going to determine the resistance that the axoplasm presents to the flow of ions down the axon. So small axons will present a large resistance, and as the diameter of the axon becomes larger, the resistance will fall and present less resistance. And as we'll see, the resistance to flow down the axon is probably the principal determinant of the conduction velocity of an action potential. I would add one final point here, and that is this particular demonstration, or this illustration, is for what are called passive properties. In this particular situation, there are no voltage-sensitive channels at all. Nothing is gated or changed by voltage. Things just pass down the membrane passively. So features that are voltage-insensitive are known as passive properties, and those that invoke or recruit voltage-gated channels, where things change dramatically, are called active processes. And what we're talking about here are simply the passive properties of an axon. So now let's consider in a little more detail how a capacitor works. And as I've indicated to you, it's nothing more than two conductive plates separated by an insulator. In this case, the insulator is air, but it could be anything, so long as it doesn't conduct electricity. And as you can see, both plates are attached by wires to a battery. Let's say the battery has a 1-volt battery, just for argument's sake. And the switch is open right now, so nothing is happening. And let's see what happens when we close the switch. So we close the switch, the circuit is completed, and all of a sudden, a humongous amount of charge accumulates on the top plate, positive charge running from the positive pole that repels the positive charges on the bottom plate, making the bottom plate negative. So this battery will transport charge from one plate to the other until the voltage produced by the charge buildup is equal to the battery voltage. So in this case, it would be 1 volt because I made the battery 1 volt. And I can plot how long it takes for that charge to build up. And that's shown on the right-hand side. I'm going to plot voltage on the y-axis and time on the x-axis. And there's that little switch, and I'm going to close the switch. And as soon as I close the switch, the current builds up immediately. That is, the charge builds up immediately on the positive plate and repels the positive charge from the negative plate, and the capacitor is fully charged. And the capacitance, by definition, is equal to the charge per volt. In other words, how many charges does it take to change the voltage across the capacitor by 1.0 volts? We won't be considering 1 volt, we'll be considering millivolts, so you can think of it as how many charges does it take to change the charge across the capacitor membrane by 1 millivolt. That's an easier way for us to think about it, but you get the point. Now, the capacitance, therefore, is going to be determined by the size of the capacitor. So let me illustrate that to you. Let's take a capacitor that's larger. It's twice the size of the other one. The plates are twice as big. And now we connect it, and voila, what you get, again, an immediate buildup, but now there are twice as many positive charges on the top plate than there were on the smaller plate, because it can hold more. In other words, with a larger capacitor, it's going to take more charge to change the voltage across the capacitor. That's the point. Now, I want to illustrate this by looking at a cell, an axon, and seeing how this idea of capacitance has meaning for the depolarization of an axon. So, here we have two axons, a very large one on the left and a small one on the right. And they both have a membrane potential, a resting potential, of minus 70 millivolts. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to inject a fixed number of charges into the large axon and change the membrane potential. I'm going to inject 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 charges. And those positive charges are going to be attracted to the negative charges on the inside of the membrane, and they're going to negate some of them. But of course, this is a large axon with lots of negative charges, so the small number of positive charges that I injected only negated a few of them, so I've only changed the membrane potential slightly to, say, minus 60 millivolts. All right. Now here's the point. I can do exactly the same thing and inject exactly the same number of positive charges into the small axon, but the small axon has a smaller number of negative charges on the inside because it has a smaller capacity. That is, the capacitor doesn't store as many charges. It's smaller. Now watch what happens. I inject the same number of positive charges in, but I can negate so many more because there are just a fewer number to negate. And as a consequence of that, the same number of charges depolarizes the axon by a much larger amount. In this case, I made up the number 40 millivolts. But the point is, for the same number of charges, because the larger axon has a larger capacitance, that is, it takes more charges to change the membrane potential by a millivolt than a smaller axon does, because the smaller axon has a smaller capacitance. That's the major point. So now I'm going to introduce something a little different. I'm going to put a resistor between the battery and the capacitor. So what happens now is that when I close the circuit, it's harder for that current to flow through the resistor, and as a consequence of that, the current builds up, but it takes time. And that can be shown here when I close the switch. Look, it took time for the capacitor to develop charge across it because it first had to squeeze through that resistor. And of course, the larger the resistor, the longer it's going to take the charge because the harder it is for the current to squeeze through. And watch what happens. Now it takes a long time. And that's what it would be like without a resistor. Now the reason I introduced this is because a resistive capacitive circuit, as this is called, is a far more realistic situation that exists in an axon than just a wire going directly to a capacitor plate. And the reason is this. Here I have an axon, and on the left-hand side I have an electrode that's going to inject current into the axon, and then I have another electrode in the axon that's going to record the membrane potential. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to inject some current, and the current is going to go and change the charge across the capacitor. That is, it's going to change the membrane potential. But it's going to take time to change the membrane potential, as shown on the right. And the reason it takes time is because the internal resistance of the axoplasm retards the flow of current down the axon. It acts just like the resistor in this resistive capacitative circuit. Hence, the membrane has what's called a time constant. That is, it takes time for the membrane to change its charge. That is, it takes time for the membrane potential to change when current flows down the axon. So now we're going to direct our attention to the membrane resistance. And remember, the membrane resistance simply is determined by the number of open ion channels that run through the membrane. So, before we can discuss that, I have to introduce a few new terms and concepts to you. They're not difficult. They might sound it, but they're not. The first is Ohm's law, which says that voltage is equal to current flowing through any circuit times the resistance of that circuit. Some of you may be familiar with it. I know some of you aren't. It's not hard. Follow the logic. If we transpose terms, and because conductance is equal to 1 over resistance, the current flowing through the circuit will equal the voltage times the conductance. And all that's saying is the higher, the easier it is to flow, and the more voltage you have, the more current you get. But we're dealing here with ions flowing through ion-selective channels. Therefore, voltage is actually a little bit different. It's called a driving force. And the driving force is equal to the membrane potential minus the equilibrium potential. So the current flowing through an ion channel is equal to the driving force times the conductance. The driving force is exactly what I have been saying in words all along, although I haven't mentioned that specific term. All it says is, if the membrane potential is different from the equilibrium potential for that ion, the ion is going to flow. That's all it's saying. And the greater the difference between the two, the greater the drive on that ion. Let's just use a few examples just to make this clearer, all right? So, let's take one example. For potassium, at the resting potential, the driving force will be the resting potential is minus 70 millivolts minus the equilibrium potential, which is minus 75 millivolts. Therefore, the driving force is plus 5 millivolts. And all that says in words is that you have a high concentration force driving potassium out of the cell. But however, the cell is very negative on the inside, which is holding the positive potassium charges inside. However, the concentration force is just slightly greater than the electrical force, and that difference is plus 5 millivolts. Thus, the concentration force tends to drive a little bit of potassium out, the driving force being plus 5 millivolts. That's all it says. Now, we can take for potassium at a membrane potential of 0 millivolts, the driving force will be much higher. In fact, it will be 0 millivolts minus minus 75, which would be plus 75 millivolts. And all this is saying is that there's a large driving force because there's a large concentration force driving potassium out of the cell, but there's no negativity holding it into the cell. Thus, there's a large force driving it out, and that force can be given a number, plus 75 millivolts. For sodium at the resting potential, the driving force will be minus 70 millivolts minus plus 55 millivolts, which is minus 125 millivolts. There is a huge driving force, and the driving force is huge because the concentration force driving sodium into the cell is large because sodium is concentrated on the outside. And second of all, it's attracted into the cell by the electrical force because the cell is negative on the inside. The two forces are working in exactly the same direction. Thus, the driving force is huge. The number is 125 millivolts. The only thing the sign means is the direction of the flow of the ion. If it's negative, the flow will be into the cell. If it's positive, the flow will be out of the cell. It's that simple. It's not more difficult than that. Okay, let's take a few examples and see what happens. So let's take an example for sodium. And here, let's say the conductance is high. Let's say all the channels are open and the driving force is large. And it's large because the membrane potential on the inside is at rest. It's minus 70. So the driving force is going to be minus 125 millivolts. And what that means is you're going to get a lot of sodium coming into the cell driven through the channel. Now, remember Ohm's law, the current is equal to the driving force times the conductance. Now let's double the conductance. And all that means is I have twice as many channels that are open. I just double the number. And what that means, I get twice the amount of current, twice the number of positive charges of sodium carried into the cell because there are two channels open. That's all it means. Now, we can reduce the driving force by making the inside of the cell minus 10 millivolts. Now the driving force is only minus 65 millivolts. You can see it up here, minus 10, which is the membrane potential, minus the equilibrium potential, which is plus 55. So minus 10 minus 55 is minus 65 millivolts. The driving force is lower than it was when the inside of the cell was minus 70. So sodium is going to be driven into the cell, but less of it. I just show that a little slower and smaller number. And if I double the conductance, I get, again, double the amount of current through the two channels that I would get through the one channel. Hence, if I double the conductance, I double the current for a particular driving force. Now, let's say the conductance is zero. Then the current is equal to minus 125 because the inside of the cell is still at rest. But the conductance is zero. The conductance is zero. No sodium can come in. There can be no current. And the same thing happens even if we double the conductance. Both of them are closed. Zero times anything is zero. And now, let's leave the conductance high but make the driving force zero. And we make the driving force zero by making the membrane potential set at the sodium equilibrium potential, plus 55 millivolts. So the driving force will be plus 55 millivolts, which is the inside of the cell, minus plus 55 millivolts, which is the equilibrium potential for potassium. So the driving force is zero. So the current has to be zero because the driving force is zero times the conductance is zero. One in, one out. One in, one out. That's what the equilibrium potential. That's what it means. For everyone driven in by its concentration force, one will be repelled out by its electrical force. There will be no net flow of sodium. And I can double the conductance. It makes no difference. The driving force is still zero. There will be two in and two out, one through each channel, but there will be no net flow of current. That's all it means. So the current equal the driving force then the conductance. And if the driving force is zero or the conductance is zero, there will be no current flowing across the membrane. So finally, we're going to be considering our internal, that is the internal resistance of the axon, which is really the simplest because it's only determined by the diameter of the axon. The larger the diameter, the lower the resistance, that is the higher the conductance, and the smaller the diameter of the axon, the higher the resistance. And let's illustrate that here. Say I have an axon. This is a large axon, and I've injected a lot of positive current into the left side of the axon, and the left side is now positive, and I want to see what kind of current is going to flow from point 1 to point 2. Point 2 is still very negative, the normal resting potential of the cell. So by Ohm's law, the current that flows down this axon should be equal to the voltage divided by the resistance of the axon, or the voltage times the conductance, whichever you want to look at it. But the internal resistance of a large diameter axon is small, so that a large amounts of current will spread down the axon, as shown here, simply by Ohm's law. You can look at it a little differently if you want to. You can say that the current will be equal to the voltage, which is constant here, the voltage difference between point 1 and point 2, times the conductance, and the conductance is very high, so you'll get a large amount of current. Simple enough. So now let's ask the same question of the small diameter axon, the one shown in the lower part of the figure. And notice the internal resistance of the small axon is large, that is, the conductance is low. So only a small amounts of current spread down the axon. So imagine we have two points, 1 and 2, with exactly the same potential differences that occurred in the axon on top, the larger axon on top. But now, because the internal resistance is so high, you would only get a small amount of current spreading down the axon. It wouldn't spread nearly as far as it did in the large axon. So it's the diameter of the axon which basically determines the spread of current down the axon, because of the difference in the internal resistance. And in the next movie, we're going to see how these features, particularly the diameter of the axon, can regulate the conduction velocity of the action potential.